Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much today to visit our FCCJ. Today we had a press conference by Deputy Special Representative for Sudan, particularly human rights, by the Secretary General of the UN. Mr. Toby Lanzer, who has a long history of the service in UN, and particularly the human rights activities. May I introduce Mr. Lanzer? But it will be a 5 or 4 minutes video from the Mr. Lanzer introduce. Please prepare and to watch carefully. Yes. Thank you very much.
Yes, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. I wish I could address you in Japanese, but I'm unable to do that, so let me speak in English. And the video you have just watched, I showed very deliberately because I thought it would be useful to transport us from this reality into the reality which we on the ground in South Sudan face on a day-to-day basis. Almost all of those images that you have just seen were taken by me with my mobile phone. Almost all of them, as I've traveled throughout South Sudan since violence erupted, since the conflict started on the 15th of December. And it is no exaggeration to say that the situation in South Sudan has collapsed entirely, and that the international community is now engaged in supporting South Sudanese people in what is, without doubt, the greatest challenge that they have ever faced. And what is, without doubt, one of the biggest aid operations that the international community has ever had to mount. Just to give you an idea of the scale, we believe, sadly, that by the end of this year, one in two South Sudanese will either be on the verge of starvation, internally displaced, or be a refugee in a neighboring country. That is how grave the situation has become. That's how quickly things have deteriorated. We have seen a shocking level of violence which has destroyed entire cities. It has shattered markets. Most traders have left the country. People have been unable to plant their crops. April and May was the key time of the year for planting. We all know that if you do not plant, you cannot harvest. And in what is largely a pastoralist society, a very proud pastoralist society, it has been almost impossible for many people, many millions of people in different parts of the country, to look after their livestock. So we have cattle, sheep, goats, which are usually the livelihood of communities, which are roaming, which are dying, and which are part of this enormous economic collapse. Now, why has this happened? This has happened because of a political failure within the ruling party. This has happened because what was initially a squabble became a skirmish and turned into a crisis of national proportions very, very quickly. And the mechanisms to resolve that crisis were not in place because the country is so young. We're talking about the youngest country in the world, a country which really doesn't have yet the institutions and the abilities that are required to reconcile and resolve difficulties when they arise, and certainly doesn't have the mechanisms in place yet to manage conflict. So is this just another country in Africa where there is no hope, and should we just forget about South Sudan? No, I don't believe that's the case at all. I'm a strong and firm believer in the viability of the state-building project in South Sudan. I think that this is a very resilient people. This is a group of communities who in the past have shown that they have an amazing ability to reconcile their differences. And this is a country which is economically not only viable, but of great interest, not only to Europe and other parts of the world, but in particular to Asia. And I think that it is for that reason that investing in the humanitarian response, as Japan and as other countries in Asia are doing, is not only a signal of solidarity with the people of South Sudan, it is also something that can pay dividends in the future. because South Sudan is situated in a region, it's surrounded by Ethiopia, Uganda, and Kenya, in a region where countries are showing consistent rates of growth of 6%, 7%, and 8% on an annual basis. I wish that were the case in my own country, and I suspect there are some people in this region who would be quite envious of growth rates that are so remarkable. So there is every possibility that with international support for reconciliation, hopefully sustainable peace, South Sudan can make it, South Sudan will make it. And it will join its neighbors in a few years' time, not only in a search for peace, but also greater prosperity. I think the other issue that I just wanted to mention before we open the floor for questions, you know, in the meantime, what is it that we are doing and what really needs to be done? There is a huge demand on the international community for peacekeeping. We have one of the largest peacekeeping operations in the world in South Sudan, and it's growing. The need is expanding. And the Security Council has now given the peacekeeping mission a very specific mandate: protect civilians, help deliver humanitarian aid, monitor human rights, and monitor the cessation of hostilities, which is, we hope, coming into effect more and more each day. At the same time, as I said, the international community is mounting and has mounted one of the largest relief operations. Actually, in any single country, this is now the largest relief operation. That's how serious the situation is. This is, in the terminology of the United Nations, a level 3 emergency. The only other countries on earth that have that are Syria and the Central African Republic. And yet, in some parts of the country, which have been unaffected by violence, life goes on. Institutions continue to function, and they continue to try to function better. And so there are many parts of South Sudan that today, as I speak with you here, there is stability. And development work is ongoing, sponsored by various partners, various countries and institutions working hand in hand with the people in the institutions of South Sudan. So that's why I'm a firm believer in this project. I'm a firm believer in the potential future of South Sudan, and I can focus very much today on areas of interest that you have, be it peacekeeping, the humanitarian response, or the regional impact of what is happening in South Sudan. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Then that will be open the floor. Firstly, will we get a question from working press, and after that, as a category of the membership. Any questions from the working press, please? Yes. Please come to the mic and identify your name and application.
Hello, Mr. Lanzer. Thank you for your speech. My name is Kosuke Tarai from Nikkei Newspapers. And I have a question concerning the literacy rate in South Sudan. I have read this data that the literacy rate in South Sudan is very low. I heard it's around 20% or a little above that. And I think that's something very rare, even for a country in Africa. So concerning that problem, do you see any problem between that issue and the humanitarian aid that you are doing currently? So to put it in other words, do you see any difficulty because the literacy rate of the peoples in South Sudan is so low? Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. I think as the video showed, at the moment our priorities are to save lives, to prevent a famine, and we are very, very close to famine, and to avert the loss of another generation. Now that third aim is less specific than saving lives and preventing a famine. So what did we mean? What we really meant with the third aim is empower children, empower the youth to look after themselves. And for that, education is absolutely vital. And so the role of emergency education in settings of this nature is a big priority for me and for the team on the ground, because we cannot condemn children because of the poor decisions taken by adults. And so you're right to point out that the literacy rate in South Sudan is dismal. It is. 20% is it can only be described as dismal, okay? 80% illiteracy is awful. But let me mention a little anecdote about a country that used to be the youngest country in the world. It's just down the road, or just across the seas, East Timor. When East Timor became independent in 2002, what was its literacy rate? Not much higher than 20%. And where is East Timor now, 10 years into independence, or now it's 12 years into independence? It's doing a lot better. Things have stabilized. The peacekeeping mission in East Timor has closed. It's come to a successful conclusion. The humanitarians have moved on. And East Timor is focusing very much on the issues of economic development and job creation. And that would not be possible if the illiteracy rate there was still very high. So this is a big priority for South Sudan. One thing that I find remarkable in South Sudan, however, is the lady shown at the end of the video, yeah, who is speaking very eloquently, not into a camera. She was speaking to me, and I was holding my phone. And she was actually giving a message to President Obama. She said, "Can you tell President Obama what's going on here?" And I said, "Well, that might be a stretch for me. I've just met John Kerry. I'm not sure I can meet President Obama." But Ban Ki-moon was coming through South Sudan. So I said to her, "Why don't you give a message to Ban Ki-moon?" And very eloquently, she said, "I've heard about the Secretary General. He's very busy around the world trying to help people come together in the name of peace. And here is my message to him." When she had finished with her very purposely delivered message, I asked her, "By the way, what education have you had?" She never went to school. She can't read or write. And yet there she was with a tremendous sense of comfort, speaking with real elegance into the camera. So yes, literacy is a key factor. It will be a key factor to take the country forward. When we in the United Nations focus on issues of rule of law, or building the capacity of institutions so that they can manage the estate, the affairs of the state, or talking about human rights, obviously having a strong foundation of education is vital. So that's something that both in the humanitarian response and in areas where we're still continuing with our development cooperation, we focus very much on education.
Thank you. Any other question from Working Press?
Yeah. Siegfried Knittel, freelancer from Germany. What kind of a role does Japan play in South Sudan? I think there has a kind of a peacekeeping troops there. But you know, there is a problem in Japan with collective self-defense. Would it be necessary in South Sudan for peacekeeping troops to protect people with weapons? And if they cannot do it, what can peace troops do in South Sudan?
I suspected there'd be a question about this. I understand there's some discussion about this topic in Japan at the moment. But so let's just talk about the role of Japan first. And it's a very important role. Japan has really been a stellar partner of South Sudan since South Sudan became independent in July 2011. And it has a three-pronged approach. One is on the peacekeeping side. And let me come back to that in a moment. Another is on humanitarian response. Japan, for example, is the third largest contributor to the World Food Program, which has a huge ongoing response in South Sudan. And then the third prong of Japan's work in South Sudan has focused very much on development, vocational training, infrastructure, and helping the government with its agriculture master plan. Now, I actually see a lot of synergy in those three areas where Japan has been engaged. Let me give you some concrete examples. At the moment, you would think, well, why would we continue, or why would we engage in infrastructure projects in South Sudan? Well, let me tell you why it's important. One of the only ways that we can deliver desperately needed relief to communities who are on the verge of starvation is by barge, long boats that go up the River Nile or down other rivers. To do that, we need to load the boats. We need a port, okay? We need a place to dock the boats. We need to make sure that the boats can move along that riverway or waterway. So Japan's engagement in infrastructure on the port in Juba is welcome, timely, and vital. Now, that was a development initiative which is now making a contribution to the humanitarian response. Another area where I think Japan's engagement is vital is on the agriculture master plan, trying to help South Sudan become food secure so that it doesn't need food aid. It doesn't need emergency food aid. Now, that will take several years. It's not something we can achieve overnight, but you have to begin as soon as you can. And Japan's engagement on this is very, very recognized. Now, let's look at the peacekeeping issue. The core mandate now of the United Nations peacekeeping mission is to protect civilians. Usually, when we think of protecting civilians, we jump to the conclusion that this means men with guns protecting civilians. It doesn't have to mean that. Let me give you some concrete examples. We believe in the concept of protection by presence. The mere presence of peacekeepers in different parts of the country makes belligerents, it makes parties to the conflict think twice about their behavior. It makes them consider whether or not to act and to harm civilians because they know that their actions will be seen, they will be monitored, they will be reported on, and that there will be consequences of their behavior. Patrolling up and down a road, whether it's on foot, along a path, or whether it's in a vehicle, you know, active patrolling is also a deterrent. And so there are different ways that peacekeepers can protect civilians. Recently, since the violence erupted on the 15th of December, we have had over 100,000 people come into the United Nations bases in different parts of the country. The Japanese engineers, which are part of the peacekeeping mission, have been vital in helping to provide enough water, bathing areas, sanitary conditions, so that those people don't get sick. So protecting civilians doesn't only mean keeping them out of harm's way, it also means making sure the environment in which they are is a safe environment and where they don't get sick. And as you saw in the video, we have had a cholera outbreak in Juba and now in other parts of South Sudan. Cholera, by the way, is endemic in South Sudan. It exists. And when there was a cholera outbreak in one of the poorer neighborhoods in the capital, we were very concerned that this would come into the United Nations bases. Well, it hasn't. And actually, the UN bases are probably the cleanest and the safest places in the capital. And this is largely because of the contribution that the engineers in the peacekeeping mission have made. So there are different shapes, there are different forms that protecting civilians can take. And I think it's fair to say that with the growth in the mandate of the, with the new mandate that the Security Council has given us to protect civilians, to help with the delivery of humanitarian aid, to monitor human rights, and to monitor the cessation of hostilities, we in the United Nations are making an increased call for greater peacekeeping contributions. And these, as I say, they can take different shapes, different forms, and different sizes.
Thank you. Yes, next question. Yes.
My name is Matsuo from GG Press, Japanese Newswire Service. Sorry for my basic questions, because it's difficult to explain to Japanese readers what is happening in South Sudan. So because in the beginning, we can see the one side is President Salva Kiir, the South Sudan force militarily. But the other side was former Vice President Machar's rebels. But I think they reached the ceasefire agreement in January and then last month or this month. So they can get the ceasefire agreement several times, but the war is continuing. So who is fighting now there? For what is are they fighting now? And what is necessary for them to stop the war? So sorry for the basic question, but I really want to know. Thank you very much.
You know, I don't think your questions are basic at all. I think they're fundamental. And I could probably have a few university students write a PhD thesis on each of those. They're very important questions. Who is fighting? I mean, it is clear that there are two protagonists. There is President Salva Kiir on the one hand, and the former Vice President Riek Machar on the other. However, the who has become more complex in the sense that they have both drawn on support from different constituents, because if you engage in a fight, you want to win. You have to win. The stakes are high if you lose. And I think there's quite a lot of concern in the international community about the possible regionalization of this issue. And this is why Ethiopia, Kenya, Uganda, and others have been very, very tough in their stance vis-a-vis the two protagonists to stop the fighting. Now, in January, when there was an initial cessation of hostilities, it really didn't work, and I think that that's recognized. On the 9th of May, however, when the two protagonists met in the capital of Ethiopia, Addis Ababa, they recommitted themselves to a cessation of hostilities, and since then, there has been a significant decrease in the scale and the scope of the fighting. And so there are positive signals. They met again on the 10th of June, just last week, and again, it seems as though they've taken a step forward, or they've taken a step in the right direction to try to come to a place where they can really reach an agreement to reconcile and, I hope, find sustainable peace. What is it that they're fighting for? I think they're probably both fighting for the same thing, which is a better South Sudan. Now, that sounds very strange, but if you were to ask them, and ultimately your question is for them, and I cannot speak on their behalf, but both of them would say, well, we are fighting for a better South Sudan. So, our message is, you will have a better South Sudan if you stop fighting. There are much better ways of coming about a situation whereby South Sudan can prosper. And I think that this is something which has certainly sunk in. And we will, I hope, see the cessation of hostilities take hold. One problem for the people of South Sudan is that there was so much fighting, so much damage, in the first 6 months, that the damage has been done. As I said, if you didn't get the chance to plant, you won't have a harvest. Now, in some parts of the country that were calm, that were stable, people did plant. And so we can expect a harvest in some areas. But in some of the key states of the country, it's really been too difficult. People are living in a sense of palpable fear. They cannot move. The only reason they move is if they're running away. And just to tell you how bad it's been in some parts of the country, I've witnessed something I never thought I would ever see. People fleeing to Darfur. So the sense of palpable fear amongst communities, different communities, who have been very deliberately targeted for no other reason than who they are, exists. And to overcome this sense of fear, to reconcile differences and find a peace which would be a solid enough platform on which to build a country is certainly some time away. And so in the interim, I think that whether you are a non-governmental organization or a UN agency engaged in food security programs or water and sanitation projects or nutritional programs to keep children alive or to provide shelter to people who are literally living in the mud, in the bush, this is a very, very urgent issue, and it's one in which I think the people of Japan should take a certain sense of pride. You know, your embassy in Japan, the embassy of Japan in South Sudan was one of the first to call me when the crisis erupted. What do you need? How can we help? Japan was one of the first countries to come forward with financial resources for UN agencies, for non-governmental organizations. And Japan has given generously. So I think there's a certain sense of pride that the people of Japan should take in recognition of the fact that they're showing solidarity with the people of South Sudan in this great hour of need. And unfortunately, we are where we are. We need to see this continue during the second half of this year. And it's worth it, because investing in the short term, helping the South Sudanese during this crisis, it will pay dividends. This is a country, as I said earlier, it's a viable project, a viable state. There are resources. Even manufacturing has taken off in some parts of South Sudan. And so, you know, I do believe that being surrounded by a group of other countries which are also growing and which are increasingly stable, there is every prospect that South Sudan can do likewise if they can get through this current crisis. And I believe that they will do that.
Thank you. Any other questions from working press? You, please.
The rivalry between both parties, this is a kind of also a kind of ethnic groups rivalry, and does religion play a role in the fights? I think before South Sudan was more a Christian religion country, in opposite to the other part of Sudan. But I don't know exactly what. Could you tell us something?
I suppose we're lucky in South Sudan that I don't think religion lies at the heart or is particularly relevant to this particular issue now. What really started as a political struggle within the ruling party has, however, had ethnic undertones. There's no question about this. We had the question for the first couple of weeks, but it became very clear that at the level of communities, there is tremendous bitterness, tremendous distrust between different ethnic groups. And this has played out time and time again. And so resolving that issue is complex, and that will take time. To put the ethnic genie back into a bottle and to manage it is not a simple thing. And to do that will require stronger institutions, a stronger set of laws, and it will require a much firmer grip and ability to manage conflict. I think, again, we need to recognize a few things here. You know, let me tell you a quick anecdote about myself. I'm English. I love football. I'm very interested in the World Cup. Now, I support, and congratulations. I support a team in London. When my team plays the team that we don't like in London, there's a lot of tension in the air. And it's real tension. And what we used to do in the past is we used to demonstrate our tension in a very physical way. Now, why doesn't that happen anymore? It doesn't happen because now there are laws that forbid it. Those laws are implemented swiftly and in very, very visible ways. And if you want to continue being a supporter, if you want to continue going to football matches, you know exactly what you can do and what you must not do. So that tension is being managed. I do not think that the really passionate fans from one team or another team have become some sort of amazing reformed human being. I actually think that it's rule of law institutions that are helping to manage that. Now, this may sound ridiculous to some people, but believe me, in the 70s and the 80s, when I used to go to football matches, I saw a lot of things happen, inside the stadium. And it doesn't happen anymore. There's been a remarkable shift. I'm not sure it's because the root cause has been addressed as much as the environment is being managed in a very different way. And this really, I think, is an important consideration, because so often when we read about problems in other countries and we think, oh, okay, it's just an ethnic thing, or it's just a religious issue, we think there's no solution. We think, oh, no hope. Why bother? Give up. Well, actually, no. And if that were my attitude, and if that were my own experience, I wouldn't be doing the job that I do, and I wouldn't be believing in the possibilities of working together with different communities and the institutions in South Sudan to help them extract themselves from this situation. At the same time, I make it very clear to the South Sudanese, no one in the international community is going to fix this. We can help, we can support, we can provide examples from other settings, but ultimately it will be the South Sudanese that need to reconcile their differences, solve their problems, and build their country. Do I think they're able to do that? Absolutely.
Thank you. Any other question from working press?
Anyone else?
Then that will be welcome from other than working press. If you have any questions, please. Yes. Oh, oh yes.
Thank you for your nice presentation. I was quite shocked, to be honest with you. And my name is Jin Shiomura. I'm running a pharmaceutical company.
You're running a
pharmaceutical company.
Aha, uh-huh, very good.
Yeah.
Okay.
My question is that there is an outbreak of cholera.
Yes.
And it is, my understanding is that cholera is very primitive disease, infectious disease, which can be controlled very easily by a simple antibiotics. And is there any, obviously there is a lack of supply of antibiotics, and you can treat cholera by a very cheap antibiotics. How is the situation of the supply of the pharmaceuticals? And also I want to know the situation of the newly born babies.
Right.
I have these two questions, please.
Yeah, thank you. So let me just give you an example of what things are like. In one of there are 10 states across the country in South Sudan, and one of them is called Unity State. It's not very unified right now. You've got two communities living there, and they really are, there's a lot of tension between the two of them. But the main town in Unity State is called Bentiu, and that town was under government control, and then the opposition took it, and then the government came back, and then the opposition took it, and the town has changed hands 6 times in the last 6 months, and every time there's a big fight over unity. Today, there are no civilians living in the city. None. It used to be a city of nearly 200,000 people. There are no civilians there. Where are they? Well, many, many, many thousands have fled into the bush, and they're just watching and waiting to see what happens. But 40,000, and maybe as many as 45,000, are inside the United Nations office compound in this town. Now, when you go back to your offices today, imagine what it would feel like if you had 45,000 people descend on the building or the compound where you are. We have struggled enormously in the United Nations to provide enough water, to provide enough sanitation services, bathing areas, food assistance, etc., in certain locations. Why? Well, because the only way you can get to Bentiu is by road in the dry season. It's not the dry season, it's the rainy season. So you can't go there by road. You can sometimes go there by barge. You cannot fly there. So at the moment, on a day-to-day basis, these 45,000 people have about 5 liters of water each per day. I want you all to imagine your life with 5 liters of water per day. You couldn't manage, none of you. I can't manage, okay? With cholera, hygiene is critical. Wash your hands before you eat. Wash your hands after you go to the toilet. Well, that's if you have a toilet, by the way. If you've only got 5 liters of water per person per day, you can't afford to use the water to wash your hands. You need it to cook, you need it to drink, because it's 40 degrees Celsius outside. So the hygiene situation is very, very poor. And so infectious diseases, very high risk of them spreading. We have vaccinated everyone against cholera. The vaccine is about 65% reliable. So far, so good. But there is a very high risk in these settings where people have less space per person than Nelson Mandela had in his prison cell in Robben Island. Less space, okay? We have about 4 square meters per person. You're in the pharmaceutical industry, you know, hot weather, desperate overcrowding, lack of water, you will have disease. It doesn't matter if it's here, South Sudan, or in my own country, England, doesn't matter. So we've really struggled. However, as I mentioned at the outset, where cholera has erupted, actually didn't happen in our bases. It happened in poorer neighborhoods, in particular in the capital. It's endemic. It happens almost every year. So we're really struggling with this at the moment, and it's a more complex issue than the provision of antibiotics. And even if we had all the antibiotics, we have had to make very difficult decisions about what to transport to this particular part of the country, because the only way in and out is helicopter. So we can take 2 tons of cargo at a time. And recently, when I was in Bentiu, around the water points in our base, there was tremendous tension. You know, women almost fighting each other because they need more water. So we've got our best engineers, the most seasoned and capable non-governmental organizations and UN agencies, drilling boreholes, looking for the aquifer that may give a bit more water. And that is just one example of many, many examples throughout the states which have been most affected by the violence. Sorry, your second question was?
Small babies.
Yeah, so, right, so. South Sudan already before the crisis had the highest rate of maternal and child mortality of any country in the world. I mean, you know, this is one of the poorest places on earth. And so on the one hand, that makes people very resilient. If you are a survivor, if you manage to reach your 5th birthday in South Sudan, I mean, you are very resilient. A mother in South Sudan, in fact, a 15-year-old girl in South Sudan has a higher probability of dying in childbirth than she does of finishing school. A 15-year-old girl in South Sudan has a higher chance of dying in childbirth than finishing school. So already before the crisis, this was a tremendously poor, poor country with some of the worst health indicators of any country anywhere, in particular when it comes to child and maternal mortality. And we have been working on that assiduously, very, very hard during the past years. Just to give you an idea, last year, just before the crisis, for the first time, the first South Sudanese women who were trained as midwives graduated. Okay? Last year, the number of skilled birth attendants who were present while a woman was giving birth doubled compared to this figure 3 years before when the country became independent. So up until this crisis broke in mid-December, there were tremendous advances that were occurring, also in education. When the initial peace agreement for South Sudan and Sudan was signed in what used to be Sudan, this was in 2005. In South Sudan, there were 300,000 children attending school, 300,000 children. Last year, that number had grown to about 1.6 million children. There has been a tremendous effort to build schools, train teachers, get kids into school. It's been a huge priority. All of this has now been put into question by this crisis which has erupted, and that's why resolving this crisis and getting things back on track is really a big priority for the international community. And in the meantime, as I said, what we have to do is not only work the political track, but also work the peacekeeping and the humanitarian track. Because as one lady said to me recently, you know, Toby, you have to tell those two men one thing. And I said, what do you want me to tell them? She said, tell them both. If we all die, they have no South Sudan. He's going to wish me luck for England in the World Cup.
Yeah, yes, I wish you, really.
It was, we need a lot of it.
Yeah, yeah. What kind of role does China play has in now in South Sudan? I think they're very interested in the Southern Sudan oil. I think they are very engaged in it. And other question about was, I think they are still the area of oil, I think there's still a dispute between North South Sudan and South Sudan. It's not all, I think there was also kind of some a war between both parts of both Sudan.
Good. I'm just wondering if there's anyone else, otherwise we could take that as the last one, but that's, that's up to you.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay, so, and then there's the lady over there, good.
Oh, yeah.
Well, China, like other countries, you know, is interested in oil. It's not only China that's interested in oil. South Sudan has oil, and India, Malaysia, China, other countries have shown great interest and invested heavily in oil in South Sudan. And that interest continues. What China did during the last 6 months is very interesting. First of all, they stayed in South Sudan and showed tremendous solidarity with the people of South Sudan, but they've also contributed to the aid effort by helping to construct a new area in the capital next to the peacekeeping mission's headquarters. And we are currently this week starting to move people from a very difficult setting in one of our compounds where there's a lot of mud. It's the rainy season. The compound has become very muddy. The living conditions for people are terrible. You saw it in the video. And we're moving those people into a new area. And China was the major contributor to the construction of that site. I am actually tomorrow on my way to Beijing. I will be discussing with the government there its contribution to the peacekeeping mission. I'll be discussing with Beijing its contribution to the humanitarian response and other matters. So regarding the border areas, I think, yes, there are unresolved disputes regarding the border. It's not terribly uncommon. There are many countries in the world that are having border disputes with neighbors. The role of Sudan in the current crisis has been interesting to watch. There were great fears that Sudan would back one or the other protagonist. We don't have any indication that that's the case at all. What we have is indications that the neighboring countries, Sudan, Ethiopia, Kenya, Uganda in particular, they're really trying to stabilize things and ensure that South Sudan doesn't implode and that the consequences of that do not have a greater impact on the region than they are already having. You know, by the way, the impact is direct. It's not only disrupting trade. It's not only the fact that the markets in South Sudan were largely managed and run by Ugandans, Kenyans, Eritreans, it's Ethiopians, etc. Yeah, so there has been a direct impact economically, but there's also been an impact of another nature. By the end of this year, we estimate that about 850,000 people will have left South Sudan for Sudan, Ethiopia, Uganda, Kenya, and other countries in the region. So this puts pressure on them and also mobilizes all of us to work together to try to resolve the problem. So let's see if we manage.
Then that's where we take a final question.
Thank you. My name is Alexandra Juhász. I'm working for Hungarian Press. My question is that, is there any particular thing that Japanese or people in Japan can do for South Sudan? Thank you.
I mean, I think there are lots of things that people here can do. I think they're doing a lot of it already. But, you know, some concrete things is, I think, the Foreign Ministry of Japan has been very engaged in South Sudan. It has mobilized resources from the government of Japan, and those resources have been provided to the United Nations, as I said, both in particular recently for the humanitarian response. I think the Ministry of Defense here has been very engaged with South Sudan, with the peacekeeping effort. And I think the people of Japan should feel a real sense of pride in their support and their engagement, and they should continue it. So that's sort of at a level of how Japan has been engaged. I know that there are also private sector considerations amongst Japanese businesses who have been looking at South Sudan. At the level of individuals, I know people from Japan who are working for non-governmental organizations that have been on the ground in South Sudan, and we hope to see them back very, very soon. And then, of course, you know, if there are people in Japan who want to do something immediate and direct, well, they can give. I mean, there are various ways in which they can give. There are associations here for the World Food Programme, for UNICEF, for the High Commissioner for Refugees, for the Food and Agriculture Organization. And the people of Japan, just like people in any economically wealthy country, or anyone with disposable income, can make a donation. We actually have a handout over there which is called A Guide to Giving. And, you know, just a concrete example. You know, I don't know how much a cup of green tea costs in a cafe in Tokyo. I have no idea how much. If you go to a cafe in Tokyo and you order a green tea, how much will it cost? 500 yen. Okay. How about an espresso? Similar. I must have gone to the wrong place. I paid much more. So for 150 yen, for 150 yen, which is about $1.50, you keep one person alive for one day. So a cup of green tea is half a week. That's what that means. So if you give, you know, 5,000 yen, or $50, you keep someone alive for a month. That's what the aid operation costs. And I think that that's a very worthwhile contribution. In fact, I just contributed that to this aid operation, and people said, yeah, but you're the guy managing it. I said, yeah, but I also have to give. I shouldn't be just managing it. And there is a way to do that online, and it's the website is tinyurl.com/South Sudan Donate. tinyurl.com/South Sudan Donate. And there's a guide to giving in the corner. It's part of this packet that starts with frequently asked questions. And that's what people can do if they feel that way. And I think people can make a real difference. So thanks for asking that. That's a great question. By the way, the Speaker of the Parliament in South Sudan was educated in Hungary and speaks fluent Hungarian, which is probably something that not that many people can say they can do. So there you go.
Yes. And thank you very much today.
Thank you.
And we're very, very impressed and vivid information and your hard work. And not only till just now, but in the future, and very, very short period, you have to work very hard. We sure is to support you, and we are very happy together with you today, this afternoon. On the behalf of the FCCJ, I'd like to present honorary membership for 1 year.
That's very nice.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Please come again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everybody. We'll be finished this press conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you.